standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. And every prayer we prayed in desperation, the songs of faith we sang through doubt and fear. In the end, we'll see that it was worth it when he returns to us.
Grace Point this morning. So glad you could be with us. This week, I was listening to a message by R.C. Sproul on the immutability of Christ, the unchangingness. Christ is unchanging. Aren't you thankful for that? We're going to sing about that this morning. Your love never fails, it never gives up, and never runs out on me. Let's stand as we sing, please.
It's so good to have you all here this morning, this beautiful Sunday. Pastor David threatened to talk about the weather this week, and we told him no, absolutely not. That's not a good thing. We are glad that you're here. If you are here for the very first time, we would love to know that. There's a card in the chair in front of you that you can fill out and lay it, put it in the offering box right at the back of the worship center there. An offering also goes in that box as well, but we'd love to know that you're here. Also, if you have a prayer request that we as a staff could pray for, we would love to do that this week as well. So there's a prayer card in there as well. The green one is a prayer card. We'd love to pray for you. Hey, we had a great time at the Valentine banquet. Who was here last night for that? It was good food. Thank you to the Smiths and their community group for putting that on. Yes, It was just a smoking hot time. But apparently not as smoking hot as Alyssa's apartment was. Apparently the oven started on fire as Seton was cooking the meat yesterday. I just thought I'd let everybody know because, you know, that's kind of funny to me. But yeah. There's smoke. Poor Alyssa's sitting in her apartment with all the windows and doors open. Anyway, it was a really, really good time. Also, we had a great prayer time yesterday morning at 8. Just would encourage you to join us for that time of prayer and of worship. It was a really, really great time. Hey, today is the Super Bowl, which we really... But we are having a Super Bowl party. It just gives us a great opportunity for the guys in the church to get together and enjoy each other's company a little bit and root for the Eagles. And I'm a Broncos fan. I can't root for the Chiefs. Anyway, but we're going to have that 3:30 until the game's over. We're going to have pizza and some snacks. Bring some snacks. If you don't have snacks to bring, come anyway. I'm sure we'll have plenty of snacks. We're just going to... What's that, buddy? And we might have pop, Matt. We might, yes. Yes. So we'll just have a great time enjoying each other's company. Also, next Saturday is a father-son ice fishing event. So we're gonna get here. We're gonna leave Grace Point about 7 o'clock, and we're gonna head up to Upper Sunshine, do some ice fishing, come back. I've heard a lot of grief. I know there's a lot of girls out there that want to go with Dad ice fishing, right? But I have a plan for a father-daughter dance in the fall. So you guys hang in there. We will have a special time for you as well. But this one is specific for men and their boys. We're going to go out and do some ice fishing. So we'd love for you to join us for that. Also, there's a Blazing Saddles chili cook-off on Saturday. And that is to support Knights of Columbus, which is a really amazing organization that just recently, one of the things they've done recently is they bought one of the ultrasound machines for Serenity through that. So it's a great thing to support because they support a lot of good things as well. So Pastor David is a judge, so if you want to butter him up this week before you take your chili, that is also an option. I think you take fives, tens, hundreds, anything like that, yeah. Anyway, so that's going to be a good time. Next Monday, on the 20th, we're going to have a Route 56 sledding party. So we're going to meet here. We're going to head up the mountain. We're going to sled. The only reason we go up the mountain is because we can take a snowmobile and nobody has to walk back up the hill. That's why we go there. So you want to do that? I'll talk with you later, okay? So that is the following Monday. That same Monday, the middle schoolers are going to have a game night here at the church. So come and join that if you're in middle school. There won't be Route 56 or GPS next week because we're doing these events on Monday. All right. Let's see. Oh, we have one more. Now, I read this announcement that says, "How we love Sunday school class." There's no commas, no anything. So I just am reiterating that we love Sunday school class. But I think, Jill, are you going to come up and do an announcement for us? Why are you moaning, Seton?
So we are going to be doing something different for our marriage class starting the 16th-ish of April, and it's called How We Love, and this book was recommended to Seton and I by David and Belle, so we have been listening to it a couple of times, and we've had a couple of other singles, marrieds, older people, and it just talks about how our family of origin really affects how we love and are loved. So it's not really limited to marriage. It does talk about marriage, of course, but anybody would get a lot out of this. And so it's going to be starting. It's a book and a study guide with just a 5-minute video. So we're going to be discussing a lot. But if you are a person that likes to get it on Kindle or audiobook, go ahead and order it there. We have about 5 books. that we can sell for those people that don't have either of those resources. But it is life-changing for us to understand how we love each other and how we like to be loved. So we really encourage you to come.
All right, thank you. And we do love Sunday school class. Amen. Psalm 115, just going to read one verse this morning. And I think this is so appropriate because I think when we get in a spirit of worship, sometimes we kind of think more about us than we do about the Lord. And this is a time to give him honor. And this verse says this: "Not to us, Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory, because your love and your faithfulness." Let's pray. Father God, you are faithful and you love us so dearly. Loved us enough and still loves us enough, Lord, that you sent your son to die on the cross, to take our sins, that we could have a restored relationship with you. Lord, help us to never forget that. And we pray and thank you, Father, for your faithfulness. Thank you for this time together that we as a church family can come and worship and give you glory. And we pray that that would be just what happens this morning as we raise our voices in song, as we listen to your word spoken. I pray, Father God, that you would empower Pastor David with your Holy Spirit to speak your word in truth and empower and encourage us to follow more closely after what you would have us to do. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. Why don't we stand, please, as we sing the next song about who we are in Christ. Hello, my name is Regret. I'm pretty sure we have met. Every single day of your life, I'm the whisper inside, won't let you forget. Hello, my name is Defeat. I know you recognize me. Just when you think you can win, I'll drag you down again till you've lost all belief. Oh, these are the voices, these are the lies, I have believed them for the very last time. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I am no longer defied by all the wreckage behind. The one who makes all things new has proven it's true. Take a look at my life. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. What love the Father has lavished upon us, that we should be called his children. I am a child of the One True King. What love the Father has lavished upon us, that we should be called his children. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child.
Sing it again.
Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. My morning song.
armies is always by my side. Nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hand. I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. Nothing formed against me shall stand.
Jesus,
kings. You are Jesus, majesty.
Affirm that this morning as we come before you. We know that day and night before your throne, the angelic beings cry out before you, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God, the Almighty, the one who was and who is to come. And Lord, as we stand before you, we acknowledge there's none like you. You alone are God. You are the living God, the true God, the real God, our Creator God and our Redeemer God. And we love you as we stand before you this morning. We just affirm your worth and the center place that belongs to you. The center place in our lives and in our hearts is yours, Lord. And this morning we come in worship. We want to surrender to you and to give you control of our lives. We pray, Lord, in this time that you would grant your Spirit to move powerfully in our hearts, that you would enable us to hear your words to us, that you would bring to mind and make active your Scripture in our lives to renew our minds and our thinking, and Lord, that you would bring hope and peace to us during these troubled days. It might be that we find ourselves in a really good place right now, and we give you praise and thanks for that. Or it might be that we're going through difficult times, and we don't know how we're going to get through it. But Lord, you know. And you have promised to take care of us. You have promised to guide us, to lead us, to sustain us. Because Jesus, you are the good shepherd, and your sheep know your voice and they listen to you. But Lord, we want to listen to you. So I pray, Father, that you would make each of our hearts here today ready to hear and to listen and to obey. Give us your hope, give us your counsel, and give us your strength, Lord. Thank you for all that you've done, for what you are doing, and thank you for what you're going to do. Lord, we know that People in Turkey and Syria are suffering untold hardship and distress because of the earthquake there. Father, we pray for them. We pray for those relief agencies that are trying to meet the need right now. Would you help them? Would you comfort them? Lord Jesus, would you bring your power to bear on that situation? And we pray that the people in Turkey and Syria would turn to you for strength, the true and living God. We pray for their comfort, Lord. We pray for your power to work in that situation. Lord, so many other situations around the world with Ukraine and Russia, other countries in Pakistan and Iran and China, on the continent of Africa and Somalia, and they're experiencing drought and famine. Father, we lift these areas up to you, and we pray that you would act and that you would have mercy. Lord, we turn to you now, and we turn to your scripture. We pray that you would make your word come alive to us, and that you would teach us, you would instruct us, and that you would help us to live better for you, more faithfully to you, Lord. We thank you, and we pray all of this in Christ's name. Amen. Well, you can have a seat this morning. It is great to be together to worship. And I wanted to invite Matt and Karen Johnson to come up at this time. And along with Oscar and Eleanor and Bintu and Bintu Lynn and Abby. I got them all, didn't I? Yes. Awesome. This is a great family. And you've probably seen them. If you haven't met them, you guys have been coming for like 6 months or somewhere along about there, yeah. And so they came off of the mission field in Senegal, West Africa, and they are back here. You guys live in Deaver, and so we have just been blessed to have them. They have also been one of those families that have just said, you know what, we want to plant here. And we want to be a part of this church. We want to be members. And they've gone through the discovery class and met with the elders. And the elders are recommending them for membership. And so we want to affirm them this morning. But you can see their precious kids here. And they have a full house. And so I haven't learned to tell Bintu and Bintu Lynn apart yet. But I'm going to get there. So... And are you Bintu or Bintu Lynn? You're Bintu. Okay. And this is Bintu Lynn. All right. Well, there's a story there, and you should ask Matt and Karen about these two sweet girls that are part of their family, as well as Abby and Eleanor and Oscar. And so we're just thrilled that you guys are coming to join with us in the work that God has called us to here, and we want to be a blessing to y'all, and I know you're going to be a blessing to us. I know that the Lord is going to use you in the life of our church as well. So if you're a member of Grace Point and you would affirm the Johnsons to be members here, would you just let it be known by saying aye? And I think that has the majority. So we are so happy about that. Yeah, I know it was a close one, wasn't it? Yeah, people hate that. People hate this whole, you know, affirmation thing, but we just want to do it, and we're just excited about it. So, yeah, God bless you guys, and we look forward to getting to know you better. Yeah. There's one other event that I want to mention to you, and that is this Thursday at the fairgrounds here in Powell at 6:30. Tom DeWeese is coming to speak about some of the implications of United Nations policies, and I believe he's tackling specifically property rights. There's a lot of talk in those areas of conversation about sustainability and whatnot, and so some people have looked at this and said, you know what? We need to be aware of what government authorities are thinking and planning and trying to put into force regarding things like property rights. There are also other issues like parental rights that have come into that conversation, which are really concerning. What are parental rights for their children, and trying to legislate that and trying to have control in that area. That's very much a concern. But I believe that Tom is talking specifically about property rights. And so that's going to be at the fairgrounds Thursday night. I am going to try to be there personally. And if you are interested in that, I hope to see you there as well, just to see what we can learn. There is also a Big Sky Worldview Forum on a very similar topic coming up March 3rd and 4th. In Billings, and so we'll let you know more about that as it gets a little bit closer. But I wanted to just reiterate, I think we've had a rotator slide going up prior to the service about Tom DeWeese. He has spoken and written in many different areas. He's a well-known speaker on these issues, and so I just wanted to pass that along to you to make sure that you knew that was an option. Thursday night, 6:30 at the fairgrounds, is when that event will be. Well, we are in Matthew 5 again. Today we're going to wrap up the Beatitudes, that portion of Jesus' sermon that talks about what is the good life? What does it mean to flourish? What does flourishing look like in this world? One of those Beatitudes has to do with the area of conflict. That's not relevant to anybody, is it? Conflict? Yeah. I read that when some years ago, Roy Rowland was a CEO of a small financial institution, he encountered some petty workplace conflict. In fact, he said, I don't even remember what the issue was. All I remember was that amongst my employees, this issue was really insignificant. But it didn't take long before the whole workplace was divided with conflict, and they were even snarling at one another, and it just built and built and built. And he went on to talk about how that had so negatively affected their business. He made the statement, you know, this might be funny when it's on a sitcom, but it is not funny when it's happening in your business, because he was feeling it on his bottom line. And in fact, there's been tons of studies done over the years about the cost of workplace conflict. And I don't know, I mean, I could throw some numbers at you, but let's just say it's really, really high, like in maybe the billions of dollars or perhaps even the trillions of dollars if you were to think about it worldwide. This article that I read said that's a lot of time spent gossiping, protecting turf, retaliating, recruiting people to one side or the other, planning defenses, and navigating the drama. More importantly, that's time not spent answering customer questions, filling orders, doing the job that employees were hired to do. And so that was what Rowland knows. He said it impacted my entire company as a result. And conflict is a big issue in the world. And it has been ever since the fall. Do you remember right after Genesis chapter 3 where sin enters the world? What happens in Genesis chapter 4? The first murder happens between Cain and Abel. And so conflict is a big deal. I was listening to a podcast this week. They were talking about some of the current issues. But there was an interesting statement. He said, you know, our culture, our nation right now is in a critical theory mood. And if you know what critical theory is, it's this way of looking at life that divides all people into either oppressors or the oppressed. And it's really overly simplistic. It doesn't really look at nuances or reasons why or behind or what's really going on. It just labels each people group or each person with one of these categories of either being the oppressor or the oppressed. And you know what comes to my mind? That if we are in a critical theory mood, what can you expect regarding conflict in America today? it's going to be awful. Because one thing that critical theory doesn't provide is a solution for peace and restoration. It is just ongoing conflict, because you see all of history, and it comes right out of Marxism. Class warfare and all of that, only now it's applied not just to economic areas, but to cultural areas and lifestyles and ethnicities and various kinds of things like that. And so conflict is something, I mean, you look around, it is hard for us, wouldn't you say, to be civil to one another? Isn't it difficult to be civil to someone that we have a different view from or that we disagree with? It used to not be so difficult to treat someone with respect, even when we disagreed with the idea. But today, it's like, no, in order to disagree with an idea, I've got to lambast the person. In order to discredit an idea, I have to take the person's character down and what they stand for and all of that. And so we have a lot of vitriol in our world today, and certainly it affects a personal level. Even in marriage, for instance. I was told about a husband who had his wife say to him, you know, if you really loved me, you would have married someone else. No, that's a joke. See, that was something that wasn't really said. But you get the point. It's like there's so much conflict, you know, if you really love me, then this. But conflict comes not only on the personal level, does it? It also comes in the national level. And we all know that. We live in a day where there is so much conflict around the world. Billy Graham, years ago, I think this was 1955, made note of the fact, and this is really staggering to me, that the world sorely needs peacemakers, and he made that point by citing the number of wars fought by various nations from 1480 to 1941. And so he just recounted that. During that period, which is slightly less than 500 years, Great Britain fought 78 wars. France, 71. Spain, 64. Russia, 61. Austria, 52. Germany, 23. China, 11. Japan, 9. The U.S., 13. Plus 110 against Native American populations within the U.S. And that was only up until 1941. So that ended with World War II, for instance. And there have been a lot of wars since that time. And then he added this comment. Someone has pointed out that in the last 4,000 years, there has been less than 300 years of peace. Isn't that amazing? I mean, that's telling. We have a difficult time getting along. We have a problem with peace. And that's why what Jesus says in Matthew 5:9 is so important for us to get today. Because what he says is, flourishing are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children or the sons of God. It's as though Jesus is forecasting the impact that the gospel, the kingdom that he brings, is going to have on the world. That by bringing the gospel and reconciling us to God, he is going to effect a reconciliation between people as a result, those who will follow his ways. And so he forecasts the impact of the gospel, the presence of the kingdom in the broader world. Jesus' reign will produce peacemakers, people who make peace. In a world fraught with conflict, Jesus builds disciples who bring people together. Isn't that interesting? You know, honestly, this really fits with all of Scripture. Jesus is only expounding upon themes that we see in the Old Testament, and then themes that are carried on throughout the New Testament. For instance, Psalm 34:14 says, turn away from evil and do what is good, seek peace and pursue it. That's a wisdom psalm inviting us to walk in the way of wisdom. We could also go to Isaiah 9:6. A child has been born to us, a son is given, and the government will rest on his shoulders. He shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. The Prince who brings peace. The Prince who makes peace. 300 years of peace over a 4,000-year history. Yeah, I think that we could learn something from this Prince. It also has to do with the Hebrew word shalom, which means not just a cessation of hostilities, but the establishment of wholesomeness and this whole concept of flourishing is built into that Hebrew word shalom. But we also see that God is the one who is about reconciling people. Look at Ephesians 2. Verses 13 through 17. Let me turn there myself as we get there. Where Paul is talking about the gospel and the impact of the gospel. He's already said, for you're saved by grace through faith. This is not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not from works that no one should boast, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand for us to do. But then he comes down and he begins talking about the hostility between Jews and Gentiles. And he says in verse 13, "But now in Christ Jesus, you who were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who made both groups into one, Jew and Gentile, and tore down the dividing wall of hostility. In his flesh, he made of no effect the law consisting of commands and expressed in regulations, so that he might create in himself one new man, one new society, one new humanity from the two, resulting in peace. And he did this so that he might reconcile both to God in one body through the cross, by which he put hostility to death. And he came and proclaimed the good news of peace to you who are far away and peace to those who are near, for through him we both have our access in one spirit to the Father." And so one of the things that we see is that God is all about peace and producing peace, real peace, the kind of peace that lasts. And the gospel has that effect. As we are reconciled with God, we begin to get reconciled with one another, and so there's this cause-effect relationship. There's also a great passage, one of my favorite, in James chapter 3, and I'll just read it off the screen, but you know, this is that passage that talks about the tongue and how the tongue is a fire, a very small part of the body, but it makes great boasts, and just as a ship is steered by a little rudder about this, you know, not very big, steers a huge ship, so the tongue. And he talks about the tongue as a fire, a world of evil. Well, he transitions from that and he says, "So who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, he should show that his works are done in the gentleness that comes from wisdom." And for James, this wisdom is something that comes down from heaven, much like the Spirit of God. "But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your heart, don't boast and deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there is disorder in every evil practice." And so we can see why there's conflict in the world, right? But then verse 17, so beautiful. "But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peace-loving, gentle, compliant, full of mercy and good fruit, unwavering and without pretense. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who cultivate peace." So James begins talking about what a follower of God, how they interact with the world. That there is this heavenly wisdom that comes down from above. And guess how that wisdom issues forth? In peaceableness. In a peace-loving atmosphere. A peace-producing atmosphere. And you can see the descriptors that he gives there, that we are to be people who cultivate peace. Now, one thing that we should understand is that this beatitude is not talking about having a peaceful disposition. It's not talking about having peace fill your heart, although that might be relevant and it might be a consequence of having this kind of peace. But more what Jesus is talking about here is the active course of action to reconcile with one's enemies. That there are things done deliberately in order to take a situation that is conflicted, whether it involves me or whether it involves two of my friends or whether it involves these other parties, that the believer, as a result of Jesus' influence in their life, moves into those situations and actively works for reconciliation. They don't just sit on the sidelines and say, well, I've got peace. They say, no, because of Jesus, I am moving into these other situations that are fraught with conflict in order to see peace comes about. And you know what that involves? That involves overcoming the natural desire for retribution, revenge, or advantage. R.T. France points that out. It might be on a personal level, and it might be on a societal level. Think about how William Wilberforce in Britain, so many years in the thick of the slave trade, said, you know what, I can't sit on the sidelines here. He didn't own any slaves. He wasn't a part of that. But what he did, he engaged. And he contended. He said, this is an immoral practice. How can you take someone who bears the image of God and make a slave of them in this cruel way? And against all odds, he made an enormous difference, and the British slave trade was ended. Robert Gulick comments, the peace intended here is not merely that of political and economic stability as in the Greco-Roman world, but peace in the Old Testament in the inclusive sense of wholeness, all that constitutes well-being, shalom. The peacemakers, therefore, are not simply those who bring peace between two conflicting parties, but who actively work at making peace, bringing about wholeness and well-being amongst the alienated. You catch the difference? You see, sometimes we only think of peace relative to my own little bubble. And as long as I have, and Francis Schaeffer said, you know what, that's one of the weaknesses of an affluent society, is we just want personal peace so that I can have my personal life pattern uninterrupted, undisturbed, and can do what I want. That's not the biblical notion of peace. The biblical notion of peace is that we move into areas of conflict with wisdom and with grace and power of God, and we seek to make a difference for him. So let me ask you, how are you a peacemaker? Maybe you're thinking right now of your own marriage. Is there peace in your home between you and your wife? It's so easy to be conflicted, and we all go through seasons of conflict in our marriages. I think if you're not honest about that, you're just flat out not honest. That's just human nature. But what's important is that we continue to work to make peace in our homes. And we continue to deepen those relationships. What about with your children? Are you a peacemaker with your children? Sometimes to be a peacemaker, you have to swallow your pride. Sometimes you have to choke it down and do what's right in order to make peace. In the workplace, are you a person who makes peace in the workplace so that people can thrive and as a result of the gospel? See, one of the upshots of what Jesus is talking about here, flourishing are the peacemakers, is that Jesus envisions disciples who are not hermits, locked away from the conflicts of the world, Rather, they're engaged in society. They're ambassadors for the kingdom of God, promoting peace that finds its source in the gospel, that all, even if it will often have a cost. Notice what he says here. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the sons of God, or the children of God. What does he mean by that? Well, that term, children of God, or a son or a daughter of God, conveys the idea that a child is someone who reflects the character of the teacher or the parent. And so that when you and I are actively making peace in the world, that we're reflecting who God is. And God is glorified in that. And so that ought to be something that is part and parcel of our following Christ in order to see peace and reconciliation grow, because it proves, it shows, it gives the evidence that we are actually children of God. Peacemakers. The world is in desperate need of them. But here's the crazy thing. The one who hungers and thirsts for righteousness and the one who seeks to make peace between divided parties will not be appreciated by the world system. Right? The kingdom of this world. That's why Jesus wraps up the Beatitudes with what comes next. Look what comes on the heels of this. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. Jesus anticipates that the conformity of his disciples to righteousness, in other words, living according to the ways and will of God, that's what we talked about. That's what righteousness means. It means my following of Christ in obedience and taking on the way that he lives and following suit. That is going to be something that puts me at odds with the world. And we ought to expect that. Following Jesus creates turbulence with the world. The system of the world will not like it. Remember, righteousness, as Matthew uses it, refers to the conformity of a life to God's will and ways, and it's expressed, it's lived out as godliness. This kind of lifestyle will bring hostility from the world, and Jesus wants his disciples to be prepared for that. But he says, flourishing are those who are persecuted because of righteousness. Do you want to flourish? Do you want the good life? Then it's going to entail difficulty and pushback and a cost in our interactions with others. Notice that Jesus closes this off with the same promise as he gave in verse 3 when he started at the very first beatitude. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. And then verse 10, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. It's like Jesus is making bookends of these beatitudes. And he's saying, if you live like we have talked about the last couple, 3 weeks, it's going to entail this kind of turbulence with the world. And we ought to expect that. The interesting thing with the one that he mentions in verse 10, this idea of persecution, is that Jesus then turns and continues it in verses 11 and 12. Look at what he says. Only here, notice the difference. He shifts from using the third person, and now he begins to use the second person, plural. And so he's been talking globally about these blessings of people who live as he describes here, and now he turns and he says, and you, and it's a you, plural, you all that are sitting on this hillside with me, this mountainside. And look at what he says, you are blessed when they insult you and persecute you and falsely say every kind of evil against you because of me. Be glad and rejoice. One commentator put it, leap exceedingly. because your reward is great in heaven. For that is how they persecuted the prophets who were before you. And so Jesus deepens this theme. R.T. France, in talking about this, says that he moves from the general statements of the first eight Beatitudes, and then in verses 11 and 12, he begins to turn to his audience gathered around him on that hillside, and he wants to drive this home just a little bit more. He says, so this is going to relate to you all, because they have committed themselves to follow him. They will now stand out from all the people around them in society. France says the second person plural is used not only because there was a group of people that he was speaking to, but also because Jesus is speaking to their corporate impact as a disciple community, as an alternative society. Isn't that interesting? That we as disciples of Jesus Christ are what we might call, what he calls, an alternative society to the world. It's a different way of living. We don't go with the flow. How many of you watch the Chosen series? Aren't those are so good. But I love the intro and the song at the beginning and the fish. You know what I'm talking about? And all the fish are swimming this one way. I think they're swimming from, you know, left to right. And then this other fish starts swimming against. And it's indicative of what it means to live as a disciple of Christ. You are countercultural. But I'm not sure how countercultural the church in America is a lot of the time. Howard Hendricks used to say, the more you are like your culture, the less you will impact it. But Jesus left us here to advance his kingdom and to make an impact. And there's really no way to reconcile popularity in the broader culture and being a disciple of Jesus Christ. Notice Jesus introduces some different words, a couple of additional words to persecution here. He says, blessed are you, you are blessed, the CSV, flourishing are you, we might say, when they insult you. And so added to physical persecution, like we might think of some sort of economic penalty or being thrown in prison, added to that now are verbal insults, slights, mockings, scoffings, all of those kinds of, Jesus says it's legitimate. Flourishing are you when you experience these things. He says another, gives another word that also relates to the verbal aspect. And they falsely say every kind of evil against you because of me. You know what we call that? We call that lies. And so people will lie about a disciple of Christ. Why? Well, Jesus says, because of me. Because of me. Wait, no, I thought it was because of what I was doing. Jesus says, no, it's because you're following me. It's because of me. And in verse 10, it was because of your lifestyle. Now, it's because of Jesus and your connection with Jesus. It's almost as though Jesus was wanting to prepare his disciples for what he knew was coming. And hasn't it been that way through history? See, according to Jewish tradition, Isaiah was sawn in two by those refusing to hear his prophecies. Jeremiah was stoned by his own people. Ezekiel was ridiculed. Amos was told to leave and prophesy elsewhere. Moses, Samuel, Elijah, and Elisha all met with severe opposition. John the Baptist had his head cut off, and Jesus was crucified. Should we expect different if we are following Jesus? You know, I was thinking about that, and I was thinking, is there, I just asked a question, Is there a biblical hero that we hold up as an example who did not experience adversity, hostility, and persecution? Is there one? I can't think of it. In the Old or New Testament, Moses, Samuel, Daniel, go down the list. So part and parcel of discipleship is experiencing some form of rejection from the world, from the world system. I realize this is not happy talk. Anybody happy about this? I'm not real. Jesus says we should be glad. Trying, Lord. Because great is our reward in heaven. You know, scores of people through history have loved Jesus' teaching because they find something powerful and attractive in it. Mahatma Gandhi, for instance, was a real, as we've said, devotee to the Sermon on the Mount and found it very impressive. But I'm not sure that people love what Jesus has to say about persecution and following him. I know it's hard for me as well. But yet it's pretty hard to ignore. Look at John 15, 18 through 20. Last night, Jesus was with his disciples. This is one of the things he said. If the world hates you, understand that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. However, because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world hates you. Remember the word I spoke to you, a servant is not greater than his master? If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will also keep yours. So you see the connection we were talking about, intimacy with God here. Here's another example of this morning at 9 o'clock. Here's another example of it. But they will do all these things to you on account of my name because they do not know the one who sent me. So there it is again, Jesus talking about these hard teachings. Luke chapter 12, look at what he says. I say to you, my friends, do not fear those who kill the body and after that can do nothing more. But I will show you the one to fear. Fear the one who has authority to throw people into hell after death. Yes, I say to you, this is the one to fear. But then he says, aren't five sparrows sold for 2 pennies? Yet not one of them is forgotten in God's sight. Indeed, the hairs of your head are all counted. Don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. So Jesus has these very stark and harsh teachings. And of course, we see it played out in the lives of the apostles and the New Testament disciples and the New Testament church. I can't remember, but a great percentage, I don't have the number on the top of my head, a great percentage of the apostles died for their faith. Tradition says Peter was crucified upside down in Rome. And so forth and so on. Is this something that we need to prepare for? Well, I think it is. I think we've said before, persecution around the world is higher than it's ever been. There are more people today living under persecution than at any other time in church history, and it's not even close. We've talked about Iran, we've talked about China, we've talked about Nigeria, we've talked about Sudan and other places like that, and North Korea, where it is very, very difficult to be a Christian. But friends, I think all of us sense the encroaching secularism in our own country and in our own nation. That ought to be attention-getting for us. This was in the UK, but just less than 2 months ago, there was a lady, March for Life director in the UK, Isabel Vaughn Spruce is her name, who was arrested for praying silently outside an abortion clinic. Praying silently on the sidewalk outside an abortion clinic. Similar things have happened here in the U.S. I think it's important that we know these things and are dialed in on them, because it's part and parcel of our discipleship to Jesus. And there have been things happening here in our nation that are somewhat disconcerting and even alarming. We need to have a mature outlook about these. Said before, and I think it has proven true. You and I need to think about how far are we willing to be pushed outside of the bounds of biblical orthodoxy before we're willing to take a stand. Because the tendency is just to say, and especially since we've been so comfortable here for so many years and protected by this notion of religious freedom, a freedom that is under attack everywhere in our country, the temptation for us is to just get along. But there's going to come a time when you're going to have to make a decision whether you can continue to work at a place. There's going to come a time when you might have to take a pay cut or not take the promotion because of the requirements that go along with it. There's going to come a time when you have to stand up to a professor and say, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to affirm a lie. I'm not going to live by lies. I'm going to live by the truth no matter what it costs. And so in whatever sphere you're in, you've got to think about what does discipleship to Jesus look like because of that. Thankfully, we have some really powerful examples of fellow believers in our nation that have done an incredible job. You know of Jack Phillips. I think I've got his picture here. Masterpiece Cake Shop in Lakewood, I think it's Lakewood, Colorado. And if you don't know the story, Jack is an artist with cakes. I mean, he can make a cake look like a canvas, and he puts, that's his calling, his life's work. He puts his heart into it. But as you know, some years ago, at least I hope you know, Jack was taken to court and sued because he wouldn't make a cake celebrating a same-sex wedding. And he was happy to sell cakes to the customers, but he could not in good conscience celebrate a same-sex wedding because it's not in keeping with his dearly held convictions that are biblical. That case went all the way to the Supreme Court, and Jack won. But did that stop the Colorado Human Rights Commission, or whatever their name is, from coming after him? No, it didn't. They continued to hound him. Finally, after some warning and some evidence that they were doing this, they backed off, but now it has started again. And Jack is currently being sued by an activist attorney because he's not willing to make a cake celebrating a gender transition for a person. And it's probably headed to the Supreme Court as well. Now, he's been clear. He will serve everyone regardless of their background. It doesn't matter what their orientation is, but he can express messages that violate his conscience. That's the difference. He'll sell anybody any cake product he has, but he won't create a message he feels violates his conscience. And see, what a great job he's done. He's done the work of deciding, how far can you push me? How far can you get me off center of devotion to Jesus, and Jack has decided that. And he's a great example for us. There was another case this last year, a little girl named Lydia Booth. And this just came out recently. A couple years ago, Lydia, that's her, wore this mask to her elementary school. The mask says, the picture's not that great, it says, "Jesus loves me" on the mask. And it was during COVID, and they had a mask policy, so she wore this mask to school, and she was told to take it off at school and wear a different mask. And then her mother got a call later that day. The mother was thinking, well, the teacher was probably having a bad day or maybe overreacted or whatever, no big deal. But they got a call from the principal saying, it is our policy, you cannot wear masks that have any religious or political messages on them. And she said, well, I've combed through the student handbook and I don't find that in there. Well, long story short, and I guess I won't go into it. But if you can go to the next picture, that's her and her mom. This sweet little girl. and they love Jesus. And anyway, they went to court over this and they won. And it isn't about being angry, or it isn't about getting back or getting revenge. What it is about standing for the truth. And not only as a result of what they've done, other peers of Lydia have started to read the Bible and have started to get interested in the Lord as a result of the stand that she took. And so all of this goes to show that this is something that is in even our backyard here today. And so we've got to be ready to take a stand for Christ. There's a sobering, you know, Hebrews chapter 11 talks about what we call the Hall of Fame of Faith, or Faith Hall of Fame, and it has all of these great stories of Abraham and Moses and all of these biblical heroes. Well, at the very end of the chapter, there is this statement, and there were others who were tortured, refusing to be released so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and floggings, even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and holes in the ground. That seems so far from what our experience is here. But maybe we need to be prepared as disciples of Jesus Christ to take just such a stand. I guess you look at these two Beatitudes, and what you see is that Jesus' followers flourish when they make peace in a conflict-filled world. And Jesus' followers flourish when they bear up under persecution, because they know they've got something coming in eternity that is beyond comparison. Jesus says, "Be glad and rejoice, because your reward in heaven is great. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." So may the Lord cause us to flourish, and may we be a people who are ready to suffer and ready to stand for Christ, that the world may know that He is God and that they may find hope in Him. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank You for the way that You pierce right into our daily lives, even, Lord, as we look at the world and the things going on around us. We know that many of our brothers and sisters around the world and in other situations in other countries have paid the ultimate price. Many of them have given their lives, and many of them are suffering even now. We pray for them, God. We pray for the believers in Nigeria, for for those in Iran, for those in China, for those in Myanmar, Lord, and we can continue listing nations. We pray for the reign of peace that comes from the authority of Jesus Christ. And we pray that our world would know peace and would know your love and that it would change our existence. And then, Lord, we pray that you would put in us as your disciples, as those who have been saved by you, as those who are following you, that you would put it into our hearts, the metal and the steel and the conviction necessary to stand and to gladly bear up under persecution. But Peter said, all who want to live godly in Christ will be persecuted. So Lord, may we rejoice and be glad as you talk about here, because our reward in heaven is great. Lord, give us the ability to love you more than anything in this world, that we would joyfully suffer and remain faithful to you, whatever comes. And we ask this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.